the Global Conference on Cyberspace, a prestigious global event being held in India for the first time. The goal of GCCS 2017 is to promote an inclusive cyberspace with focus on policies and frameworks for inclusivity, sustainability, development, security, safety.
His Excellency Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe. We now present before you a captivating 3D mapping show on Connected Cyber World India and GCCS.
It's the mass market. 2017, 3.5 billion users. Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana offers easy access to banking services. Aadhaar is the world's largest biometric ID system with over 1.171 billion enrolled members. BharatNet project launched to make connectivity of the broadband in the gram panchayats across rural areas. Government of India formed citizen engagement platform. Government e-marketplace is the technology-driven platform to facilitate procurement of goods and services by government bodies. Digital payments, making India cashless. This platform and mobile app to facilitate a single point of access to all government services.
Welcome to India, the land of rich, vibrant and colorful culture with unity in diversity. Welcome to the land of a prominent leader in the world of digital and knowledge economy. On the occasion of the Global Conference on Cyberspace GCCS 2017, we extend a very warm welcome to the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, and the Honorable Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, His Excellency Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe. On behalf of Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Government of India, we extend a very hearty welcome to all the distinguished dignitaries and the esteemed delegates who have come from all over the world and India. Now, let's watch GCCS film.
Welcome to the land of ancient civilization. A land that connects your inner world to the cyberspace. A land that invented zero, just zero. The land that charms digital giants of the world today. Welcome to the land that is always online for innovations. India. Leading one of the biggest digital drives of the world. The digital world is full of connections, actions, and emotions. It gives voice to the speechless, security to the weak, eyes to the blind, wings to the downtrodden. It's a world without boundaries. No passports, no visas are required. It creates competition, tough competition, but the only goal is growth. Like in the real world, there are online demons too. But there always are some invisible digital angels to protect your cyber world. In this fantastic world, let us create some space for everyone who envisions to build a better cyber sphere. Let's create an inclusive cyberspace that promotes development, peace, and freedom. That encourages technology and partnerships for upholding digital democracy. Our Prime Minister believes in the philosophy of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. Collective efforts, inclusive growth. Let us take this philosophy to cyber level with ideas like cyber for growth, cyber for digital inclusion, cyber for security, cyber for diplomacy, collectively resulting into cyber for all. Realizing our dream for a secure and inclusive cyberspace for sustainable development. Once again, international trade leaders, policy makers, industry experts, think tanks and cyber authorities from more than 100 countries have assembled to deliberate on issues and challenges involved in the cyber world. Also, thousands of people are participating through video conferences and live webinars from across the world. Today, the world is rapidly moving towards digital empowerment, digital equality, and digital identity. The demand for digital services is huge, and the opportunities are unlimited. The next big digital revolution is right here. Let's take this giant leap towards a secure and inclusive cyberspace for everyone's happiness and growth. Welcome to the biggest ever conference on cyberspace. Welcome to the 5th Global Conference on Cyberspace 2017. Connections, actions, emotions. Welcome to the land of ancient civilization.
Taking the inspiration from the visionary leadership of the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, and his vision of Digital India for transforming India, Honorable Minister of Electronics and Information Technology, Law and Justice, Government of India, Shri Ravi Shankar Prasad, is passionately committed to ensure that each citizen is empowered with the access to digital services. May I request Honorable Shri Ravi Shankar Prasad to kindly deliver the welcome address.
Honorable the Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi ji, His Excellency the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, Ranil Wickremesinghe, my distinguished colleague in the Council of Minister, Manoj Sinha, Minister of Communication, Minister of State, K.J. Alphonse, Secretary General of ITU, Mr. Holland Zhao, distinguished ministers from 26 countries who are here, Excellencies, National Security Advisor Shri Ajit Dobal, officers, delegates, ladies and gentlemen. Let me greet all the delegates from abroad, the traditional Indian form of greeting, Namaste. This is not a greeting simpliciter, but the coming together means this is you and this is we. And the coming together means let's come together for amity, world peace, and a safe and secure cyberspace. Welcome to Cyberspace 2017, New Delhi. A journey which began from London, then Budapest, then Seoul, then The Hague, and now New Delhi. And we are seeking to erect an architecture, a rule of behavior to make the cyberspace safe and secure. And India's civilization, 7,000 years old, a great heritage, has two abiding principles. What is that? Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, the whole world is one. Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, let all be happy. And based upon these eternal principle, what you just saw, our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi's vision is Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. Namely, a development model which is inclusive, but powered by technology. That is what Digital India is about. Our view is any digital initiative must bring in digital inclusion, bridging the digital divide. And most important, must be powered by technology which is affordable, which is developmental, which is inclusive. And therefore, because of the great initiative of our Prime Minister, the UN model of sustainable development is getting a new footprint powered by technology. Ladies and gentlemen, what is the digital profile of India? In a population of 1.30 billion, 130 crore, India is home to only 1.21 billion mobile phones, 121 crores. 1.18 billion Aadhaar, digital verifiable identity, completely safe and secure, backed by a parliamentary law. Third, 500 million internet. Now what we are doing? To bring in inclusion, digital movement must become mass-based. We opened 300 million bank account of the poor, underprivileged, call it Jan Dhan, linked to Aadhaar with a mobile, and started sending financial entitlement directly to the bank account. More than 500 million people got that entitlement, and we have saved only 57,000 crores, close to $9 billion, which used to be pocketed by middlemen and fictitious placements. Our motto is, digital governance is good governance. Digital delivery is faster delivery. We are erecting optical fiber network, 250,000 cluster of villages, 100,000 completed. A big model of inclusion is our common service centers, 270,000, where 1 million boys and girls and entrepreneurs are involved in digital delivery of services. And many of those entrepreneurs have been children of farm laborers, illiterate, but today acquiring digital literacy, they have become vibrant symbol of digital delivery. Those are signs of digital empowerment. But to the need of India, we have tailored digital delivery of services. How? You saw that eNAM for farmers, 400 markets. E-scholarship for students to get their scholarship. E-hospital to get patients connect to their doctors through digital technology. And host this whole, our other involvement of people of India in governance, which you just saw displayed on the screen. But above all this is creating a big digital market because of the big market of 1.3 billion plus Indians. And digital economy of India is poised to become a $1 trillion economy in the coming 4 to 5 years. That's what we are working. Obviously, internet is important because based upon our commitment of funding the unfunded, banking the unbanked, securing the unsecure, giving voice to the unheard, taxing the untaxed, digital economy is playing a crucial part. But internet has also to become democratic. If internet is a big global platform, it must have linkage to the local ideas, local culture. That is the very clear focus of India. Therefore, right of access is not negotiable. Yes, being a democratic country, India upholds privacy, governed by the rule of law and constitution. But privacy cannot prohibit innovation. That's what we feel. Data analysis, data growth are big instrument of future growth. We wish to push that. And most important, privacy cannot become the shield of the corrupt, of the terrorist, and the extremist. That's how we have to balance the whole idea. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if these are the nuances, these are important to secure a safe cyberspace. Because internet, to be of great use to the humankind, must be safe and secure. Terrorists, extremists, hackers are not able to foment trouble by abusing and misusing this great invention of human mind. That is where our responsibility becomes very important. Abusing this platform for child pornography, again, it is a serious issue. We'll have to reflect, coordinate, share, and imbibe the best practices. That's what cyberspace is about, and therefore, we have given four things to ourselves: cyber for growth, cyber for digital inclusion, cyber for security, and cyber for diplomacy. Digital diplomacy must become integral to strategic diplomacy. That's what we feel very strongly when digital world is becoming an all-expansive world. These are some of the themes from the ancient land where was invented the zero and geometry, and now is the fast progress of digital inclusion. In this land of India of diversity, welcome, and I'm quite sure the interaction of 2 days will lay the foundation of a future roadmap which is safe and secure. Thank you. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, Honorable Shri Ravi Shankar Prasad. We are deeply honored with the gracious presence of the Honorable Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, His Excellency Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe. I now invite the Honorable Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, His Excellency Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe, to kindly address us on this momentous occasion.
His Excellency Narendra Modi, Prime Minister of India, Honorable Ravi Prasad Ankur, the Minister, Honorable Ministers, distinguished speakers, and friends. It is fitting that the 5th Conference on Cyberspace is held in India, where from the time ancient, the Vedas were chanted nearly 4 millennia ago. The search for an overarching, unified, and a singular truth began. This particular quest has led to a wealth of metaphysical discourses and debates that navigated what is unreal and real, or delusion and truth. The relationship between the spirit, the mind, and the physical body, as well as the nexus of time, space, and substance. Your logo, the Bindu, comes from the land of the primeval language of Sanskrit, where the great Aryabhata's mathematical work on place value system led to the rise of the concept of zero. And today, under the leadership of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, you have committed yourselves for digital inclusion for all Indian citizens and more for within South Asia. I am privileged to address you today on a topic that is of such significance to us all, that of the cyber space. In this day and age, the theoretical truths of yesteryear have now transformed into actual existence. These ever-expanding new frontiers have become so invaluable to our daily lives that, if we so desire, we can exist in an alternative reality as a personal avatar. Bearing this in mind, it becomes necessary to delve deeper into the topic of creating and maintaining a safe, secure, and inclusive cyberspace for all that will in turn impact positively on sustainable development. For you will agree with me that new age of data dominance in the history of human civilization has dramatically changed the way we think, the way we behave, and the way we live in an unprecedented manner. Today, cyberspace has become a repository of information and knowledge, a key determinator in wealth creation, human development, and social transformation. Yet, we are all aware that the exponential growth of the internet, digitization, and access to information communication technology have posed additional challenges to human society at large. Among these, we find that the accepted and traditional definition of liberty, individual freedom, and human rights have been rigorously challenged due to the very availability of information worldwide and easy accessible of data. This confluence has now arrived at a point where we need to consider the ethics of cyberspace. For instance, we need to strike a balance between individual freedom and the free flow of information and data. And the way I see it, good governance in cyberspace will play a pivotal role in striking this balance. In any sphere, be it politics or cyberspace, we find that transparency is an integral component of good governance. For instance, in Sri Lanka, we formed a government based on the idea of good governance in January 2015, and ensuring transparency was a top priority on our reformed agenda. Yes, politics is my domain, but from what I comprehend, the same rules apply to governance of cyberspace as well. Transparency is central to ensuring durable cyberspace security. Hence, the idea of extensive transparency is gaining credence among many of the global decision makers as it fosters and advocates the durable development of cyberspace. Here, it is important to understand that contrary to traditional thinking, the use of open data does not compromise the idea of security, given that such data can contribute towards gathering more significant and accurate intelligence. For instance, back in 2011, a supercomputer was able to pinpoint Osama bin Laden's location with startling accuracy at a time when human experts thought he was in an entirely different country. When the University of Tennessee's researchers fed news articles up to April 2011, it was Nautilus supercomputer that correctly predicted Osama bin Laden's precise location in Pakistan, up to 200 kilometers. This was the time when many believed that bin Laden was hiding in Afghanistan. Even more disconcertingly, it was able to predict several cultural and political trends, including a populist uprising in Egypt and the overall stability of Saudi Arabia. These, I must say, are good examples to underscore the remarkable advantages posed by open source data analysis for security purposes. This can be more effective than collecting and using data in a clandestine manner without a well-specified target infringing on liberty and individual freedom. Parallel to this is the need for ensuring net neutrality, a right that has come under serious challenge in many parts of the world, including the United States, due to reasons ranging from extremism to liberalism, and the power of cyberspace to support the free floating of hatred, hostility, and unethical content. As you know, net neutrality is the basic principle that prohibits internet service providers from speeding up, slowing down, or blocking any content online. It has been the guiding principles of the internet and the way the internet has always worked. Net neutrality lowers the barriers of entry by preserving the internet as a fair and level playing field and helps small businesses and entrepreneurs to thrive online. Similarly, the open internet facilitated by net neutrality allows marginalized and oppressed segments that are not adequately represented in the mainstream media to tell their story and to mobilize for justice, as we have seen in recent times. I can relate a personal experience in this regard. When we were political activists of the opposition in Sri Lanka, before January 8, 2015, we had to undergo political adversity that included the blockage of ISPs, which prevented dissident voice from speaking freely online. When we came to power, we made good on our promise to ensure freedom to use the internet by removing state-orchestrated website blocks and other forms of restrictions in cyberspace. Every segment in society was encouraged to speak freely online, as we understood that it was one important way of building up inclusivity not only in cyberspace, but also in the society at large. As a result, today I have become one of the most disreputable and maligned persons in Sri Lanka. While I understand that we in Sri Lanka have a lot more to do in the area of net neutrality, but I am glad to say that our government is determined to make progressive and revolutionary steps in this regard. I am also aware that India, the world's largest democracy with the second most populous internet user base, took a critical step in this direction when it issued regulations in February 2016 to ban zero rating, the practice where ISPs were given preferential treatment to selected services or applications influencing the user experience and distorting competition. Thus, as government, we are fast acknowledging the backbone of the digital economy and its enormous potential to fast-track progress, especially on the UN Sustainable Development Goals and the way to improve people's lives in more ways than one. I am sure your deliberations will concentrate on the fundamental role of cyberspace in the improvement of education, the battle against climate change, and the promotion on gender equality and diversity issues, as well as other areas that are crucial for sustainable development. No doubt that the first four conferences have resulted in a focused dialogue towards an agreed set of rules that will support and sustain a safe, secure, and inclusive cyberspace. Given that there is no legal instrument that can be enforced in cyberspace, I wish you the best of luck in gaining a consensus on such an ethical framework of governance. I am sure you are more aware than I am of the increasing urgency of an agreement, given some of the lapses and lacuna of internet use and abuse that have also been highlighted in recent times. So let me again wish you all success, and in my language say, are you born or may you live long. Thank you.
Thank you, His Excellency, Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe. Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, urges us to bring the world into our mobile phones. Umang, Unified Mobile App for New Age Governance, is an initiative of Digital India which fulfills Honorable Prime Minister of India's vision of mobile governance. Now we present before you a short film on Umang. We now invite the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, and Honorable Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, His Excellency Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe, to kindly come to the dais. I also request Shri Ravi Shankar Prasad, Honorable Minister of Electronics and Information Technology, Law and Justice, Shri K.J. Alphonse, Honorable Minister of State for Electronics and Information Technology and Tourism. Shri Manoj Sinha, Honorable Minister of State for Communications, and respected Mr. Harlan Zhao, Secretary General ITU, to please come to the dais. May I request the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, to kindly digitally launch the Umang mobile app. I request Honorable Minister of Electronics and IT to kindly hand over the mobile to Honorable Prime Minister of India for the launch of Umang mobile app. Today, on this historic occasion, two books will be unveiled. The India Book presents India's prolific growth story of digital empowerment and digital governance in cyberspace. And the Coffee Table Book is a compendium of success stories which aims to promote knowledge sharing among the countries on four focus themes of GCCS 2017. We request the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, to kindly unveil the India Book. India Book is a compilation of articles from India's luminaries, reiterating the transformative and inclusive fabric of our collective digital India efforts and the journey towards $1 trillion digital economy. We now request the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, to kindly release the Coffee Table Book. The Coffee Table Book covers the four focus themes of GCCS 2017: cyber for growth, cyber for inclusion, cyber for security, and cyber for diplomacy. Thank you, sir. I now request the Honorable Prime Minister of India to kindly give the awards to the International Hackathon winners of Global Cyber Challenge 2017. Hundreds of teams from India and other countries participated in Global Cyber Challenge as a runner-up event of GCCS 2017. In the category of most innovative idea towards startup, the winner is Team Astra. Congratulations. Most innovative idea towards startup. Team Astra is on the stage. In the category of Peace-a-thon National, the winners are Team SciGuard. Team Tech Wizards. Many, many congratulations. Team Deep Safe. Team Deep Safe is on the stage and receiving the award. Congratulations. Team Blue Monks. Please give them a big round of applause, all the teams. Best International Team. The award is backed by 80s. Capture the flag contest, and the winners are Team Bit Vijays. Many, many congratulations to all the teams. Team Eavesdropper. These are the winners for Capture the Flag contest. Team Eavesdropper. And after that, the Team Dark Coat. Team DCUA. Many congratulations to all the winners. Thank you, sir. I now request Honorable Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, His Excellency Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe, Honorable Shri Ravishankar Prasad, Honorable Shri Alphonse, and Honorable Shri Manoj Sinha, and respected Mr. Harlin Zhao, to kindly take your seats. Under the pioneering and promising leadership of the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, New India is emerging as the land of technology prowess and witnessing an unprecedented digital revolution. May I request the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi, to kindly address us, guide us, and show us the way forward.
His Excellency, Shriman Ranil Wickremesinghe, Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, ministers from India and abroad, Secretary General of ITU, other distinguished dignitaries, delegates from over 120 countries, students, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you to New Delhi for the Global Conference on Cyberspace. I also welcome all those who are joining this event remotely from across the world over the internet. Friends, we all know how cyberspace has transformed the world over the last few decades. the senior generation among the gathering here would recall the bulky mainframe computer systems of the 70s and 80s. A lot had changed since then. Email and personal computers brought about a new revolution in the 90s. This was followed by the advent of social media and the mobile phone as an important vehicle of data storage and communication. Expressions such as the Internet of Things and artificial intelligence have now become commonplace. These indicate that change continues perhaps at an even faster pace now. These rapid developments in the digital domain have mirrored immense change in India as well. Indian IT talent has been recognized worldwide. Indian IT companies have made a name for themselves globally. Today, digital technology has emerged as a great enabler. It has paved the way for efficient service delivery and governance. It is improving access in domains from education to health. And it is helping to shape the future of business and economy. Through each of these ways, it provides the less privileged section of society a more level playing field. On a macro scale, it has contributed to emergence of a flat world where a developing nation like India can compete on a level footing with developed nations. Friends, technology breaks barriers. We believe it validates the Indian philosophy of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, the world is one family. This expression reflects our ancient inclusive traditions. Through technology, we are able to give meaning to this expression and indeed to the best of democratic values. We in India give primacy to the human face of technology and are using it to improve what I call ease of living. Empowerment through digital access is an objective that the government of India is especially committed to. Digital India is the world's largest technology-led transformative program, which is paving the way for our citizens to avail digital services. We are using mobile power, M-power, to empower our citizens. I'm sure most of you are already aware of Aadhaar, which is the unique biometric identity of a person. We have used this identity to liberate our people from queues and cumbersome processes.
three factors. First, financial inclusion through our Jan Dhan bank accounts. Second, the Aadhaar platform. And third, the mobile phone have greatly helped reduce corruption and brought transparency. We call this the JAM, J-A-M, or JAM Trinity, Jan Dhan Aadhaar Mobile. Through better targeting of subsidies, the JAM Trinity has prevented leakages to the tune of nearly $10 billion so far. Let me share few examples of how our digital technology is becoming a great facilitator for ease of living. Today, a farmer can access a variety of services such as soil testing results, expert advice, and a good price for its produce at the click of a button. Digital technology is therefore contributing to increase farm incomes. A small entrepreneur can register on the government e-marketplace and bid competitively for supply of goods to the government. As he expands his business, he also contributes to lowering the cost of procurement for government. This leads to increased efficiency and a greater value for public money. Pensioners no longer need to present themselves in front of a bank officer to provide a proof of life. Today, a pensioner can leverage the Aadhaar biometric platform to provide this proof with minimal physical efforts. Women form a significant part of the IT workforce. Digital technology has facilitated several new enterprises led by women. In this way, the IT sector has contributed towards gender empowerment. Citizens of India are increasingly adopting cashless transactions. For this, we have created the Bharat Interface for Money or BHIM app. This app is helping the movement towards the less cash and corruption-free society. These examples show the power of technology in improving governance. Friends, we are using the digital domain to facilitate participative governance or Jan Bhagidari. When we assume office in May 2014, many people, particularly youngsters, express a keen desire to share their ideas and work for the nation. It is our firm belief that there are millions of Indians whose transformative ideas can go a long way in taking India to new heights. Therefore, we launch the citizen engagement portal, MyGov. This platform
enable citizens to share their thoughts and ideas on important issues. In many key policy areas, we received thousands of valuable suggestions. Many logo and emblem designs for various government initiatives today are the result of crowdsourcing and competition on MyGov. In fact, even the official app from the Prime Minister's office is the result of competition floated on MyGov, which received brilliant responses from youngsters. MyGov is a prime example of how technology strengthens democracy. Let me turn to another example. On assuming office, I realized that important government projects and initiatives often suffer on account of unnecessary silos in government functioning and the lack of focused decision making. Therefore, we devised a cyberspace-based platform called Pragati, or Proactive Governance for Timely Implementation. Pragati in Hindi literally means progress. On the last Wednesday of every month, I meet top union and state government officials for a Pragati session. Technology breaks silos. Sitting in our respective offices, aided by the cyber world, we discuss and resolve important governance issues. I'm happy to share with you that the Pragati sessions have resulted in faster decision making through consensus in the larger interest of the nation. Pragati has put back on track the infrastructure projects worth billions of dollars which were stuck in red tape. I have even tried something on my own through the Narendra Modi mobile app. This app deepens my connect with the citizens. The suggestions I get through app are very useful. Today we launch the Umang mobile app, which will provide over 100 citizen-centric services. At the back end, these services will be catered by many different departments of the union and the state governments. This integrated approach will add an automatic layer of peer performance pressure in the working of these departments. Friends, we shall be happy to share our experiences and success stories with the global community. On the other hand, India is keen to find scalable models and innovative solutions in education and health using digital technology. We also wish to make cyberspace an enabler for the differently abled people. Recently, during a 36-hour hackathon, college students suggested solutions to chronic problems that were put forward by ministries. We look forward to learn from global experiences and best practices. We believe that growth happens only when we all grow together. Cyberspace remains
a key area for innovation. Our startups today are looking to provide solutions to common everyday problems and improving the lives of the people. I am confident that the global investor community will recognize the immense potential waiting to be tapped from India's startup pool. I invite you to invest in this space and be a part of the unfolding story of Indian startups. Friends, the internet by nature is inclusive and not exclusive. It offers equity of access and equality of opportunity. Today's discourse is being shaped by Facebookers, Twitterers, and Instagrammers. Social media platforms are making cyberspace participative for all. News that experts tell us from studios is now supplemented by the experiences highlighted on social media. This transition to a blend of expertise and experience is the contribution of the cyber world. The internet has become the ideal platform for youngsters to showcase their creativity, capability, and capacity, be it in insightful blog, a beautiful musical rendition, artwork, or theater. The sky is the limit. Friends, the theme of the conference, Secure and Inclusive Cyberspace for Sustainable Development, also highlights the importance of securing this vital asset for mankind. The global community needs to approach the issue of cyber security with confidence and much as with resolve. Cyberspace technologies must remain an enabler for a common man, for the people. The quest for an open and accessible internet often leads to vulnerability. Stories of hacking and defacement of websites are the tip of an iceberg. They suggest that cyber attacks are a significant threat, especially in the democratic world. We need to ensure that vulnerable sections of our society do not fall prey to the evil design of cyber criminals. Alertness towards cyber security concerns should become a way of life. One of the major focus areas should be the training of well-equipped and capable professionals to counter cyber threats. Cyber warriors who will remain alert against cyber attacks. The term hacking may have acquired an exciting, even if dubious, overtone. We need to ensure that cyber protection becomes an attractive and viable career option for the youth. On a related note, nations must also take responsibility to ensure that the digital space does not become a playground for the dark forces of terrorism and radicalization.
information sharing and coordination among security agencies is essential to counter the ever-changing threat landscape. Surely, we can walk the fine balance between privacy and openness on one hand and national security on other. Together, we can overcome the differences between global and open system on one hand and nation-specific legal requirements on the other. Friends, emerging digital technologies could impact our future in ways that we cannot yet foresee. Important questions of transparency, privacy, trust, and security may need to be addressed. Digital technology serves to empower mankind. We must ensure that it continues to stay that way. The large multi-stakeholder participation at this event is proof of the global endorsement that this platform has received. Nation states, the industry, academia, and civil society all need to work towards a formal collaborative framework. This will enable a secure cyberspace which improves quality of life. Friends, this conference is perhaps the biggest ever such event in terms of members. I'm told that all the background and logistics have been handled digitally. I hope delegates from around the world found it a smooth and seamless experience. I conclude by wishing you fruitful and productive deliberations and outcomes. I once again welcome you and wish the conference all success. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Honorable Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, His Excellency, Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe.
Honorable Prime Minister of India, meeting the dignitaries.
This marks the conclusion of the inaugural session of GCCS 2017. Thank you all once again for participating.
The fifth edition of GCCS 2017. Being hosted by India, with over 100 countries participating in this prestigious event. Digital technologies are today offering new avenues to make the society more inclusive using technology. GCCS 2017 aims to gather the experts of digital inclusion to draw a roadmap for an enhanced inclusive society. That's all we have from the live presentation of GCCS 2017. Jai Hind.